So in this talk, I'm primarily concentrating on how the microservices will change your IT strategy, or how it will change your IT culture, and what are the problems we will see when we try to adopt the microservices. So if your organization is already having an architecture, why do you have to worry about microservices in the first place, right? So what we are going through now is the digital transformation. So Paul talked about the software is eating the world in his keynote. This is a nice paper. So basically, the paper talks about how your entire life, your day-to-day life, is consumed by the software. So whatever the task you are touching is going through a software, right? So if you look at any of the organization now, the software is considered as a competitive advantage, not as a cost center, right? That means your business, your resources, your business, your assets, everything is controlled by the software. So what that means is you need agility in your technology, your people, in your process, in order to win this particular market, all right? So the agility means cost of change, pace of change, quality of the change, etc. That's where the microservices comes into picture, right? So again, our trends in software development is also changing nowadays. People are talking about autonomous teams, people are talking about agile development, continuous delivery, people are talking about you don't need to worry about the infrastructure. They are talking about platform as a service, function as a service, serverless, containers, etc., etc. So all of these comes into the picture, and then that's where the microservices world hit the market and gained the momentum, right? So again, at a very high level, microservices is you split your functionality into small pods or small functionalities, independently living together, and you have some services exposed through the API, and then you build your applications by consuming those services, all right? So again, there is a different track going on microservices, so I will not go too much deep into the architecture related. I will mainly talk about the cultural effects of microservices. So again, with the microservices, the architecture, what advantages it provides is it can be polyglot, it can be independently scalable, resilience, and et cetera, et cetera. So all of these advantages will put some effect on your IT strategy, on your IT culture, on your development culture, and so on. So that is what we are primarily going to look in this particular session. So how it is going to affect your IT strategy, right? So selection of technology, right? I talk about polyglot, I talk about independent teams, right? So what will happen when you have an autonomous team and there are a selection of technologies available, the team is free to select some technology which they like, right? And then they will implement the services, they will implement the functionality by using the technologies. But then the cultural problem there is, like each team will come up with a new technology. They are free to choose any technology, which will result in lots of technology in your organization, right? So when we do that, it's very hard to find talents, very hard to switch people from one team to the other, very hard to see how the other services are implemented and so on, and you will end up with a situation where you have lots of technologies and lots of moving parts, etc. Right? So what the IT culture, IT strategy is going to affect is now you have to worry about how to control the technology selection, right? Again, when the moment you have lots of technologies into place, every time there is a security upgrade, so every time there is a license upgrade, so every time there is a change happening, bug fix happening, all of that is going to affect the way your organization is working. So somebody have to keep track of what are the third-party technologies which we are using, how do we upgrade them, how do we modify them, and how do we change them, etc. So what it means is basically you need to have a governance process around these technologies, and your organization should have a strategy to define when a new technology is adopted, what are the policies you had to go through, what are the compliances you had to go through before you approve the process, approve the technology. Right? So that is one of the biggest issue when these autonomous teams and open technologies are allowed in order to build microservices. So the second is the agile development. Again, the services have to be implemented on a very loosely coupled way with bounded context, meaning it has a clearly defined functionality, and then the interaction between the services is happening only through interfaces, right? So when we do that, first aspect is the team should own all the aspects of the development. It can be like coding, it can be development, testing, user experience, documentation, performance. All the aspects has to be owned by the team, right? This is again become, will hit as a very big cultural shift when you are moving from monolithic system to the other microservices system, because team often arranged in a monolithic system in a way like one group is doing the development, the other group is doing the user experience testing, another group is actually doing the quality assurance, some people will do automation, and so on and so on. So the cultural shift here, or the mentality shift here, has to be like single team, a group of people owning the entire aspect of the development, right? And then again, we had to go into an automation mindset. Often, people will come back and say, no, some of the services cannot be automated, right? If you can't automate something, you will not be able to achieve the agility, right? If you had to release every day, if you had to test them manually, your release agility or the amount of work you can do will be bottlenecked by how much of manual testing you can do. So again, the automation mindset has to be there. Again, one of the other aspect people say is, okay, so we are releasing often, we are releasing on a daily basis, so it's totally fine to go and break the build today because we can fix it tomorrow. If you totally fine to go and break some functionality today so that you can fix it tomorrow. So that particular mindset has to go away, right? Again, you had to have lots of dashboards in order to show that. Shevan showed the build dashboard. Paul also talked about the build dashboard. So for example, we have a build dashboard. We have a dashboard which shows if a service is down, it will be shown there. If the build is broken, it will be shown there. So again, it pushed back to the team saying, okay, you are doing daily releases, but still, if there is a build break or functionality break, that's kind of a level one issue. You had to go and fix it. So you had to move fast, but yet don't go and break anything. So that's again a cultural. It has to come as part of your culture. Team. Again, the team has to be like small. Again, it's a concept called two-pizza team invented by Amazon. Again, the cultural problem here is cultural shiftness here is often in a monolithic system, you have a bigger teams. When it got shrink, again, there will be lots of interactions will go away. And then when you have the services, which are independent, and you interact only through the interfaces, the team will not know the internal details of the other services, right? Often, if you implement services in this particular way, people will, over the time, will feel like, okay, they are working only on a small scope of problems and not a bigger scope of problem, and that will affect as a cultural effectiveness, right? So there has to be a leader who motivate the people, who keep the focus within the group, within the context defined by the group, and then have to work together, right? Then the Conway's law. Conway's law tells us the architecture of the system will depend on your organizational grouping of the people, right? Again, we had to be very careful on defining the teams that not affecting the architecture of the solutions, right? And then one other problem we might end up is the teams reinventing the wheels, because of there are two small teams, and then they will not know what the other teams are doing. So they had to know what are the functionalities already available. So there has to be a catalog of already implemented functionalities so that they can take it, they can reuse it rather than reinventing the wheel, right? So in a bigger teams, people will interact with each other more and they will identify some of the functionalities. But when the teams become small and small, there has to be, the organization has to have a policy or place where people come and say what are the services already available, and you go and figure out a service catalog or service registry where you go and figure out what are the already implemented functionalities rather than reinventing the wheel. Again, interdependencies of services will become a problem. So there will be like thousands of services you will implement. And so if somebody goes and modify one of the services, it might affect affect the functionality of huge system. So impact analysis is very important. So there has to be a way to do impact analysis. So what does that mean is, each service should know, we had to have a metadata somewhere to say what are the services people are talking to each other, right? So the problem is, if in the microservices architecture, even a single service failure might affect your entire system, might affect the SLA of the system. So again, we had to design the system in a way that we mask the failures, or the component failure shouldn't affect the service level agreement of the entire system. Again, how do we identify the unused and repairable services? So when you have thousands of services, again, when the services are running, possibly some services are rarely used, but still it is used on once a month or once a year, et cetera, right? So how do you identify what are the services which are not used versus what are the services rarely used? And how do you identify what are the services which can be repairable, right? So if I am a service author and I don't know who are the people who are using the service, once I put it, there is no way to take it back unless we identify the impact analysis of the services. So this is, again, will become a biggest issue. Debugging, testing, performance will also become an issue. Generally, the people will tend to test only their services, but then the impact of the effect on the service on other systems, et cetera, will be very high. So that if a system is failing, debugging is going to be an issue. So we had to do a distributed debugging. So the team or the IT culture has to move into that particular mindset. How do you identify a failure across a distributed system and try to find it? Performance is again same. Your performance of your system is now depends on so many other systems. So again, these calls are going through network calls. So when a performance hits, you have to be able to identify and analyze to find where the actual problem is. So all of this is important. Scalability, again, the mindset of the scalability will be different. When you have thousands of services, each of the services can scale independently. So when you design the system or when you design the service, don't assume any assumption about the scalability factor. For example, people tend to assume there will be like three or four instances and then do the session management or the token handling, et cetera, by assuming n number of instances will be running, but based on the load on a particular system, it might scale vastly, and then all your assumptions will go away. And if you put the assumption into your code, that's going to be an issue, right? Again, the scalability, scaling up is very easy, because when there is a new, when there are lots of loads comes, you can easily scale up. But scaling down is not that easy. Let's say you have thousands of instances running, and each of the instances can run like 100 messages per second, but at the moment they are handling only 10 messages per second, so you had to have a way to rebalance and scale down. All of that logic has to be implemented in your system, right? So people who are implementing the system has to understand the cost optimization aspect, scaling up and scaling down, and has to be part of your architecture when you are implementing the services. So when you do that, so possibly there might be some instances which are not used. So how do you identify what are the services or what are the components which are not used? For example, again, you scale up to like 1,000 instances, and now only like 500 instances are handling your load. How do you go and reclaim other 500 instances, right? How many of you heard about Janitor Monkey? This is similar to the Chaos Monkey from Netflix. They have another system called Janitor Monkey, which goes and figure out what are the instances which are not used, and then go and reclaim the instances. So all of that kind of thinking and the architecture has to be built in, baked in into the system. Data layer scalability is, again, a biggest problem, because each of the services manage their own data stores, right? So the scalability at the application level or the logic level is easy, but still it might end up with a bottleneck on the data store level, right? If 1,000 instances are connecting to a single database, then that will fail at that will get bottlenecked at the data level. So how do you scale the database is again a problem. So you can do sharding, etc. That's how you might end up with multiple services. But then again, because of the independent scalability, still people have to worry about the scalable factor of the data layer as well. Talk about observability in his keynote. So there are several aspects of observability here. First thing is the individual service health. So we had to identify what are the services and how healthy they are, what are the scalable level they have. What's the scalable level of individual services? But that's a bit easy, right? That is just checking the health of individual services. However, since there are lots of moving parts involved, you had to identify what are the scalability or what are the health level between the integration points, right? So that's very hard. So you had to design for that. Like, for example, if a message is going, how do you do the message tracing between multiple systems? So when the log messages are there, how do you identify what happened in the system by analyzing the distributed logging system, etc., right? Then again, one of the other important stuff is you monitor the interdependencies between the services, right? So you define your service has to be used by three other components, but at the runtime, there are like thousands of components are using your service. So there is obviously something wrong, right? So the way we define the interdependencies between the services at the design time and the way the interdependency is actually working at the runtime has to be comparable, right? There is a surveillance part involved here. You have to understand what are the message passing between the components at the runtime in order to understand how the actual system works in the runtime versus how it is supposed to be done in the design time. So you can do a differentiation between those two areas to identify potential problems or potential improvement points you can do. Then potential hotspots, again, you can identify by using the observability. If you identify some of the hotspots at some points, you can scale it up or scale it down based on the needs. And so on. Resiliency is, again, important. The system has to be designed for failure. Again, this is different thinking should come from day one for the development team. They had to design the system for failure. There are lots of components, moving parts involved. If the system is not designed for failure, then definitely it's going to fail. So there are several automated tests like Chaos Monkey, which will go and kill one of the instances. There is a Chaos Gorilla or Chaos Kong, which will go and kill the entire data center. there are several other, like Dr. Monkey, Janita Monkey, and so many monkeys available, etc., to do all the works, right? So again, from day one, the system has to be designed by considering the resiliency and the failure factored in. So replaceability is one of the concepts in microservices. Basically, you have implemented one service and you can take that service out and put some other service in, right? So the components has to define, or components has to depend only based on the interfaces defined, but not based on the implementation details, so that you have the full replaceability available. What this gives you is possibly you can do zero downtime migration, so that you implement some new functionalities, you put there are something called blue-green deployments. So basically, you have the new system and the old system running together. You can route to the new system. The old system, and when the new system is stable, you can switch to the new system, etc. The same way, you can try some new experiments. So there is some deployment called canary deployment, which you can route a percentage of traffic to the new system. If it failed, then you can switch to the old system. But if it succeed, your experiment succeeded, you can switch to the new system later on, right? So the replaceability and the live migration is very important there. Again, the people who are implementing the system has to understand that the services which are available might go and come back in runtime. So try to depend only on the interfaces, but rather don't depend on the implementation details. So transaction is a bit of a tough job in microservices. So if you look at microservices, each of the service manages their own data store, right? So if you had to do a transaction between two services, it's a bit hard to do by using a distributed transaction, or it's hard to do using the database transaction level. So if you look at any of the transaction-based applications, generally the transaction is handled at the database level, or if there are multiple data sources involved, you will involve distributed transactions. But in the case of multiple services, when you are invoking services through network interfaces, especially when they are asynchronous services and so on, distributed transaction might also fail because of the latency issues and so on. So again, the system has to be designed for compensation-based transaction. So you might have to do some operations, and if the operation failed, you might have to do a compensation rather than do on a transaction basis. So again, it's a trade-off between the distributed transaction versus your latency and compensation versus your consistency on the system. So again, most of the distributed systems and microservices are designed with eventual consistency in mindset. So when you have like thousands of instances handling your transaction, possibly half of the instances might go into a particular state, other half might eventually catch up. Again, the system or the application has to be designed with the mindset saying possibly some of the data you are getting is not a consistent data, and eventually it will get into a consistent state. Security is one of the biggest concern in the case of microservices because of the dynamic service discovery and calling. Again, the services comes and goes. There are new services added, there are new variants of the services added. So the perimeter is very fluid. The conventional way of you handle using the firewall, et cetera, might fail because some of the services might be coming from outside your firewall, outside your control, coming from your partners and so on. Some of the services might come and go so that you can't define a particular firewall rule, et cetera. These services has to be secured by using tokens. When the application tries to log into a service, it might give the credential to the application, and eventually it has to pass to the different services. So you had to define the service or declare, you had to develop the services by passing tokens, etc. So the OAuth or some other ways of passing tokens on authentication has to be considered here. The intrusion detection is again a bit of a hard here because of services coming and going. Again, there has to be technologies defined or the framework defined so that the intrusion detection and authentication will be very easy. Otherwise, the implementing services will be very costly if each of the service author has to define their own way of handling the security. So now the microservices also gives you a good way to experiment and then fail fast very easily. Because these are small services, you can you can do the experiment very fast. You can implement some new services, do switch between services, etc. to try out. You can do A/B testing and see whether it works or not. But that has a downside as well. So because it's very easy to do experiments, people will tend to do lots of experiments and fail. If all the tests you are doing are failing, then eventually it will become a productivity hit for the organization, right? So again, we had to have a catalog of what are the experiments we have already tried, what are the stuff we succeeded, what are the stuff we failed, et cetera, for other people to come and look and see the experiments are worth or not worth, and so on. So everything becoming easy is also will affect the culture of the organization because, again, people will tend to take it very lightly, saying, okay, if it fail, I will adjust it next week, and et cetera. But that will become a productivity issue eventually. So the organization has to have a clear vision on how to do what to do, et cetera, when we go in this mode. Testing is a bit harder than the monolithic testing. Again, there has to be multiple levels of testing. There has to be a unit testing. There has to be a testing for the individual microservice. There has to be a testing on integration between multiple microservices and eventually end-to-end service, end-to-end testing with the applications and so on. Again, the system has to be designed and test for failures. So we had to simulate multiple failure scenarios, multiple latency issues, slow backends, and et cetera. So the testing methodology has to be defined. There can't be a separate testing team in order to do that. So again, the team has to go into a mindset of the testing and automation has to be done within the team itself. So they had to have the proper technology background in order to do that. So the people, at least part of the team, has to become the champion of automation and testing and has to take it inside. So versioning is going to be one of the biggest change from the monolithic system. Because of the lots of moving part, you can't go and break the existing systems. Again, that's why you need the impact analysis and et cetera if you are modifying some of the interfaces. So versioning has to be baked in from day one so that you don't go and break anything there. And it has to have a backward compatibility. So until the services get moved into the new version, we had to have the backward compatibility and the system should continue to function the same. Continuous integration and continuous delivery has to come from day one again. So the services which we are building has to go into the production then and there and have to be running. So this particular cultural shift has to be championed by someone and has to take into the system. So every time somebody sends a pull request, somebody commit into the source code, it has to eventually, it has to then and there, has to go into the production system or at least to the staging system so that people will identify what are the problems there. So there is a talk from Dakshika talking on CI/CD in detail, so I will not go into the details here, right? So how WSO2 helps on the microservices evolution is like You can have services in multiple levels. So you can do the services at the core level, and then you can write composable services, and then you expose them as API, and then eventually there will be consumers who are using. So the core services can be written using microservices framework for Java, MSFOJ, or by using Ballerina. So the actual core services or the atomic services can be written by using these two technologies. Then the composable services can be written using Ballerina. We will have a separate track on Ballerina, so we will talk more about how do you write composable services, how do you write microservices using Ballerina, etc. Then the services can be exposed in API Manager. You have different API gateway fronting all of these services so that you can have integrations between them. Then security is handled by the identity server. Again, identity server provides all the single sign-on OAuth capabilities that can be achieved using the WSO2 identity server. Analytics server, WSO2 data analytics server, will help you on observability aspect. You can monitor the environment. You can extract out what is going on in your runtime, do surveillance part, etc., by using the data analytics server. So that's the end of this talk. Any questions? I would happy to answer. Yes.
Simplifying that. Thank you. So if you take the traditional way of using OSP and then exposing the services, now your OSP is getting replaced with your gateway and your composite and other microservices. So now in this scenario, how you are going to simplify that? Because the failure, because if you see, you have got an API service, then it comes to composite service, and then from there, again, it goes to more atomic service. So, I mean, how this is getting simplified compared to your traditional services?
Yeah, so one thing is composite services are not needed always. Right, composite services are, if you want to combine some services in order to provide some business functionality, then only you use the composite services. So the actual masking of the failures will happen at the microservices level. So there has to be some registry related information. So in order to connect that, possibly it has to go to a place where you go and look up for a service and then find the service, etc. So if a particular service got shut down or if the service got crashed, there might be some other new services has to get created and so on. So there's a concept called service mesh, which identify what are the service interactions between the services and managing the interaction between them, etc. So we are looking into those areas now. I haven't put any of those here, and there is a part of called governance by surveillance, which is identifying the message passing between them, extract it out, and identify potential problems between the message passing between the service layers, etc. Again, that is something we are working now. I haven't mentioned here. So all of that will come into the picture to identify what are the stuff failing. But still, so there will be a meta level. It will go and get what services are running. So this particular service, or the consumer will consume the service by just looking at the key or looking at a service name, but not bind to a concrete service like this, right? So that's. Any other questions? Thank you. Thank you very much.